Okay. Which connects the mass eigenstates to the flavor eigenstate. In the case of non-zero and non-degenerate masses, one has the usual matrix. In this case, the oscillation parameters are essentially guided by two main quantities. The delta m squared, the difference between the mass squared, and essentially the energy and the distance, which dictates how the phases evolve. One of the things we don't know of the three flavors of the neutrino, whether M3 is the highest, that M31 is the highest or is the lowest. And this is one of the things which affects very badly any other measurements that we want us to do. There are also other things which are remarkable in this matrix. This has stopped advancing for some reason. Which makes it a very peculiar thing again, is that in the case of CKM, whatever is out of the diagonal is very tiny. In the other case, is very, very much spread. And as Gino was saying this morning, this is a puzzling thing. And maybe that we have some other prejudices, or we don't understand that there might be something very deep inside that. So, first of all, we would like just to think that neutrinos should behave pretty much like the quark sector, the lepton sector, so they should violate CP. We have indication that is the case, but we would like just to measure not only if it is real, but how much it is. Measure that phase with a good precision. The other thing is that we want just to understand what is the mass ordering, because it has implication on many things, including the fact that you cannot measure unambiguously this CP phase unless you know the mass ordering. And then we would like just to have hints why these two matrices, which in principle, in our very symmetric vision of the world, should be pretty much similar, they are so different. And then, as it was done for the CKM matrix, we would like just to know whether this PMNS matrix, again, CKM, the first name is an Italian, PMNS, the first name is an Italian, is unitary or not, or there are more states, because in order just to, even before we have seen the other states, if we prove that this matrix is not unitary, we know that there is something. And then there are things which we cannot probe with accelerator experiment, but can be done with neutrino-less double beta decay. For instance, just to the nature of neutrino themselves. Are there Dirac particles? Are there Majorana particles? And then what is the mass of the neutrino? Experiment like Catherine and others are looking at that. And not only that, there are things that are done in many aspects, including getting limits from cosmology and from the measurement that you do, for instance, of the cosmic microwave background. So it's clear that with this question open, there is a lot of activity ongoing and somehow programmed for the near future. There are big experiments going on, like T2K, big and successful experiment, or NOVA. There are experiments which are almost there, like UNO, and there are experiments which are a bit more distant, but not so far away, like HyperK and and do. After all, searching for CP violation is easy. One gets a neutrino beam, an anti-neutrino beam, measure the probability of oscillation from nu mu to nu e, since accelerator beams are mostly nu mu because you are producing them from the decay of mesons, and then takes the difference, and this difference is connected to this famous phase. Non scorre più. No. Ora. But unfortunately, there is a problem, because this would be easy if essentially we could do experiment in vacuum. Because if we go with neutrino through real matter, matter is fortunately for us not symmetric. So essentially there is an effect, which is called matter effect, which depends on the fact that neutrino find a lot of matter just traveling from one place to another, unless they use a Gelmini tunnel. And in this case, you can find a difference in these two probabilities without any need of CP violation. So essentially, because there is a dependency on the forward weak scattering amplitude, which depends on the mass hierarchy and on the energy, and changes sign for neutrino and antineutrino. So there are then two possible strategies. One is that you make the oscillation length, and therefore the energy of the beam, relatively small and short, and you forget about matter effect, because it becomes negligible if you don't cross too much matter. And this is the way, for instance, you do that in hyper-K. Of course, you have just to wait that somebody tells you what is the mass hierarchy before you can declare victory. Or you make it a very long baseline, higher energy, a wide band beam. And in this case, you measure the two things together, and you unfold by the energy dependence mass hierarchy from CP violation. And one is the case of hyper-K, and the second one is the one of Du. Of course, it's clear that being the cross section so small, you need a lot of neutrinos, you need a lot of big detectors, because you want just to have statistics. And so all these experiments are into the gigantic corner. But it's not enough, because at some point you understand and you see that systematics are becoming more important than statistics. And in these systematics, when you measure events in the far and the near detector, you see in this convolution integral how many things you have just to understand. And they are all function of energy. Cross-section of function of energy. And since you cannot make 10,000 ton of hydrogen here and there, you have just to use as material a nucleus. And our fellow theorists, they don't really know how just to calculate it within the required precision we need. So you have just to get smart there, and try just to make a near and far detector as possible using the same material in such a way that first order, you factorize this part that you don't know, but only the first order, because then the dependence of what is a neutrino after 1,300 kilometers and what you see a neutrino near the target is totally different, because you have just to measure very well energy, the flux of neutrino here and there, the direction, and many other things. So you need just to put a lot of attention how you do the near detector, because the near detector is the name of the game in this object, because otherwise your sensitivity disappears. Just to give you an order of magnitude, now the most sophisticated experiment like T2K or NOVA, after years, they are a large group of very experienced people, have systematics which are, depending how optimistic you are, how much you believe to machine learning, between 7% and 10%. In order just to make a relevant measurement in this matrix, you have just to bring down this thing to 1%. And it is a totally different job. So both these experiments, since they are there, and since they need time just to accumulate statistics with the neutrino, they can do other things. One of the things, since they have a large mass, since they have a very sensitive detector, they can look at nucleon decay, lifting the limits or getting lucky. And then can do things like neutron, anti-neutron oscillation. They can look at the atmospheric neutrino, solar neutrino, and if they're lucky, the next supernova will explode one day after they have commissioned the detector. Otherwise, they have just wait another 35 years or so. And in this case, this detector can provide an enormous amount of measurement, both for neutrino in itself as elementary particle, then for the dynamics of the stars. DUNE has been put together by putting together two communities, which was one concentrated in US, which was called LBNE, Long Baseline Neutrino Experiment, and one in Europe, which was called LBNO, Fantasy was not the must in these two, which was Long Baseline Neutrino Observatory, because observatory is a bit more classy. And we're putting it together, and there was, say, we go in a place which is called LBNF, because it was not used, Long Baseline Neutrino Facility, and then we do an experiment there, and we find a name for it. And the name was DUNE, Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment. It's essentially easy. And the worm excavates the tunnel. And essentially, what was there, clear from the beginning, is that this was a different way in which in US you do an experiment. Because for the first time, it was done under the so-called CERN model. The host state, the host laboratory, owns the infrastructure, whereas the governance of the experiment is of the international collaboration, to which, of course, the US groups participate. This was when it was funded. Now it has grown just to be very close to 1,500 people out of 33 countries plus CERN. And this is one of the key elements of this experiment. We use a wide band beam. So if we can measure very well the neutrino energy which has interacted, we have access to all the oscillation, not only the first oscillation, but the second oscillation peak. And we can optimize the beam in order just to do that. And the other thing is that we don't need just to buy numbers from the atom. We measure all the numbers we need in the same experiment, which is very important for the systematics. And we do it by having an experiment which can look at the disappearance of the nu mu and the appearance of the nu e. Okay, these have in the years we have gone from the initial optimism in which we have done more refined things, which are published now in form of technical design report, And sensitivities, whatever they mean, because they always assume that we are able just we, at our best to see, to control the systematics, tell us that we'll be reasonably fast to measure mass hierarchy, and it will take longer depending on where, if the CP is maximal, violation is maximal or not, it will take longer just to do that. I can jump this dead. I will simply spend two words on the fact that there is competition. There is competition between DUN and Hyper-K, and people say, well, is it worth just to have to experiment? Yes, nobody will believe to a single experiment with a single systematics in a measurement which might, depending how it turns out, just to open up new avenues. And then these are sketches of the other things. For instance, in the proton decay, DUN, for instance, as a specialty compared to the Cherenkov experiment like Hyper-K, that can look at particles which are not emitting Cherenkov light. And this, for instance, one of the decays which is foreseen in some supersymmetric theories. And the same, the fact that you can look at very low energy products with the sensitivity of argon doing excellent tracking and calorimetry is a help. And this is plots that we do just to show how well we can do in case of supernova. One of the most demanding thing for the supernova is not only having sensitivity to very low energy electrons, but also is that the supernova, when it explodes, it keep sending information for minutes. And you have just to never to stop. You have just to start going for, and so far we know that we can get to get all the information of the big detectors, the far detectors, for probably between 2 and 3 minutes. So INFN decided just to be in this business for the historical reasons for which we are also very collaborative with our American colleagues. And from the beginning, it was decided that it was getting involved both in the near and the far detector in such a way that we can have not only being contributor of hardware and of skills, but also have a firm foot in the use of the data and of the analysis. And INFN has also contributed a lot to other two things, one of which I will not talk, but is just starting taking data, which is a short baseline experiment, which happens all in Fermilab, where we try just to either to clear these famous LSND anomalies of a sterile neutrino, just bringing in Icarus, and for the first time doing a real experiment, in which there'll be a near detector, there will be a middle detector, which is MicroBoon, and the far detector, which is Icarus. And we are starting taking data now. And as you remember, here we have built the cosmic ray tagger, which is now on top of Icarus. The other thing where INFN contributed was on the accelerator, because in order just to get a lot of neutrino, you have just to do a very high power Linac and system. And so the system which was weaker was the Linac. And so they are building now a continuous wave, a superconducting Linac, which will allow just to have a power out of the main injector, the one which goes to the target of 1.2 megawatts, which are essentially thought just to be upgraded to 2.4 megawatts. And we have provided, for instance, for that Italy has provided some of the superconducting cavity. And for the rest, for the experiment, we will contribute with Chloe and with a huge investment in the light collection system of the far detector. let's talk now, what are these detectors? So the detectors are located in this gold mine in the Black Hills in South Dakota, at 1,500 meter underground. This mine is a fantastic place. It arrives to 2.5 kilometers depth, and it has about almost 600 kilometers of galleries. And of course, the galleries in a mine for digging gold, they are not good for putting in an experiment. So we are excavating there, big cavern, which are these three big caverns, in which there will be the detectors into cavern, which at the end of the game will be four different detectors. And then there is a middle cavern, which is for all the The chosen technology was liquid argon, where again Italy was one of the people who invented the place where this was invented by Carlo Rubbia, and this has grown on steroids because now one of these cryostat is about 66 meter long, 19 meter wide, 80 meter tall, and there are four of them. Two of them at the beginning. And of course, you don't do a thing like that without convincing yourself that you can do that. And this was done essentially by large effort at CERN with the extension of the North Area, where two large size prototype cryostat were built, and they're used just to test the engineering components of the detector, the real size component of the detector. The technology which is used, you cannot think of making a 70 meter by 20 meter by 20 meter cryostat using vacuum, because you can calculate how big the walls would become. So it was used a thing which is used in a thing which is becoming popular now, which is the how you line the tanks which are carrying liquefied gas. So one of our problems now is that this is becoming more expensive because there is a lot of request. And this is a sophisticated thing in which you make essentially a structure. In the case of a ship, is the ship itself. Then you put some insulator, which is a form of a very dense foam. And then you put these membranes, these plates, which are designed in such a way that when this thing cools down, they deformate in such a way that they don't break. They adapt to the thing. And of course, when we started doing things, there are two companies in the world capable of doing this, mastering this technology. One of them is in Europe, it's called GTT. And when we started, of course, for them, we are not, even if to us it looks big, we are not business, because 66 meters is a very small ship, but they were interested because the level of leak rate that we need for this detector was for order of magnitude of what they could provide. And now they have a technology just to make this thing, and they're very happy, and they put us in their clients, and so just to make them. Then what you do once you have this beautiful, you fill it with argon and you put in chambers. Wire chambers or other things. You put in some voltage in such a way that you have electric field, and you have things just to ionization drift from a cathode to an anode, where you pick it up and you reconstruct. This is a TPC, is a slow TPC, because the problem is that electrons are already slow when drifting in gas. When drifting in liquid, they are very slow. Just to give you an idea, it's 2 milliseconds a meter. So it's you can almost count it with the clock. Then what you have just to do, and this of course was a technology invented, proposed by Carlo many years ago. And at the end, if you have a set of wires, you can not only collect the charge, but also use the induction of the charge when it goes through in such a way that you have a stereo vision of the track, and you can reconstruct the thing. Of course, in order just to reconstruct this track, you have just to count the time. And in order to do that, use the light which is produced by the particle which is ionizing the thing. The liquid argon is a pretty good scintillator. It emits about 40,000 photons per centimeter for a minimum ionizing particle. So you put in a light collection system, which is used both for giving you the T0 and also just to measure independently the calorimetry of this track. And of course, when you have just to fill up such a big surface, you have just to get smart, because you would like just to have some concentration system. And the one which was invented for that is rather smart. It's called Arapuka, in which essentially when light hits this interface, gets shifted, and then inside there is a chromatic filter which avoids it just going back. And so you force it into another filter, which at the end brings it to your sensor. And this is proven in the prototype just to be very, very effective. The second module, the first module, so is done with chambers, as you have seen, wire chambers with this zigzag pattern, just to have the previews. The second module, we thought out just to simplify it more. And suppose that you put a cathode in the middle, and you put some pixelized readout on the anodes, and you put the field, in this case, from year to year, and in this case, from year to year. And so, essentially, you'll have a volume which is open. You can have your electronics on top and on bottom, and not. And then you can put your light collection system on the cathode and on the walls of the field cage. And this is, we call it vertical drift, which improves the amount of fiducial volume that you can use in the thing, and diminish the number of channels. Of course, as all the good ideas, it has some problem, because in order just to drift electrons in argon, you need 500 volts per centimeter. If you have 6 meters, you have just to have a system which puts 300,000 volts without becoming fireworks. And so it's one of the things that has been tested at CERN in the protodune. The other problem is that you would like just to cover also this cathode, which is at 300,000 volts, with sensors for the light, because you would like just to collect that light. But it's clear that you cannot bring there a device which needs power supply with copper, because there is no insulator there which will be good enough. So we have developed a way in which we can power up the electronics there, just bringing in power over a fiber. So we bring it with an optical thing, and this again is working now. The near detector is the other story. And as I told you, this is the name of the game. You have just to control all these things in the near detector. And so the near detector is, as a matter of fact, a near detector complex. There is a part which is done by a largish liquid argon detector, and then a magnetized spectrometer, which will move sideways by in steps of a few meters. This dimension is about 30 meters. When you move sideways, if you have a broadband beam, you're selecting kinematically a beam in this energy. So you can control your scale, and you can measure have a more solid way in which you measure this cross section in beans and you reproduce the thing. Of course, again, it comes at the cost of having more less statistics, because as if you move sideways. Not only that, you need somebody who stays on axis and tells you, listen, it's not that you see this beam because you are exploring this shape of the beam. It's the beam that has changed because the target, the layer of water around the target has changed by 2 millimeters. The target has moved by 1 millimeter and things like that. And this is one of the main tasks that the on-axis detector has to do. And the better it does, the more it can add, not only to beam monitoring, but to making independent measurement of all the parameters which are. So we have designed it in such a way that we can tell in a week that something has changed at the level of 4 or 5 sigma. So at 3 sigma, probably we can tell it in hours for many things, which is not damaging the far detector, because in the meantime, you will have got probably 3 events maybe in the far detectors. And but we want also to measure and independently the flux, the flavor, because the beam is almost pure, but is not pure. It will have not only a new moon, it will have a short percentage of anti-new moon, a short percentage of anti-new E and new E. We want just to measure as much as possible the all the degeneracy that could come from this convolution integral, from correlation between cross-section, flux, your efficiency and your acceptance. And then we would like, without substituting all the thing, but in case of desperation, just to be there capable of just, let's say for the first year or two, good enough just to do at least the mass hierarchy. And of course, when you have the luck that you were guided to build an experiment which is solid, elegant, and it has not things which are excessive, but all the things which are needed are there, you can think just to use it again. And this was our idea. Of course, we will have just to throw away this beautiful, not throw away, to extract, because we need mass. We need mass there. And this is exactly the contrary of what you need in a neutrino experiment. And it is even helium and aluminum inside that. Terrible. But for the rest, we'll try just to use it, the calorimeter, which is still state of the art, the magnet, which has 43 cubic meter of volume inside, and the fact that it has it is known in its performances, and it has proven that as we built it, we can redo it, reverse the arrow of time, take it out piece by piece, and bring it there. When it stopped, it has proven that this paranoia. Paolo was, as was said by many people, a person who was very deep inside what is needed for doing certain physics and what instrumentation is needed. On top of that, he was also creative, because he liked not just to do things as usual. So it was an enormous teaching, permanent teaching, talk to him, discuss ideas under the vigilant eye of Juliet, because we were allowed just to discuss from 7 to 8 in the evening, but then we had just to write our things and do our things. And Juliet on that was participating to the discussion, but keeping the clock. Paolo and myself, we had the tendency just to overrun a bit on that. But this experiment is still, these are 2018 data, is still performing very well. And And then you have just to put a tracker inside. What we are putting inside is a nice idea, which was brought in and developed, but was brought in by Roberto Petty from South Carolina, which is you put in a light tracker, which is heavy enough, or a heavy tracker, which is light enough. You put in something which has interspersed into a very light construction, some targets in such a way that you don't throw away your momentum resolution, also because neutrino will interact any place in there. It's not like in the collider experiment in which we are used. And you use targets which are done of polypropylene, which is a compound of carbon and hydrogen. Is the plastic which has the most hydrogen compared to carbon. Two hydrogen for each car. In this case, if you put also from time to time some pure target of carbon, you can subtract the events which happen. All the events happen in the targets because the rest is almost massless. You can subtract and you have solid hydrogen. And solid hydrogen you can calculate with a small error. And so you can use it for many things. Then, if you are smart, you put inside, you have carbon, we put inside some argon, a small amount of argon. We have lead, we have a lot of lead. So we can compare all the models across many different nuclei and then discuss with the theorist which one is better. So essentially, this is how sand is made, and sand is stays for a system for on-axis neutrino detector. So is of course, if you have dune, you have sand, the liquid argon detector is called grain. And then I think we stop there. And essentially, this is very, has been designed and is still being optimized with very detailed simulation in order not to be over-optimistic. And one of the things, the novelty in there, is that we will use this liquid argon, a small volume is about 1 ton of liquid argon, and read it out only optically. We will take picture of the tracks in there. We have done prototypes. We are doing now a real size prototype because it will not have incredible resolution. But what we need is that we know that the vertex is located in there. Then we have a spectrometer around it with chambers, a calorimeter, and a magnet just to measure the products. The statistics we will get, and I think it's important that you see this, we will have millions of neutrino events. Now, for some of these things, there are a few thousand, you know, all the world. And this will allow us just to make a lot of measurement, not only for the oscillation, but also for general physics, because we can do deep inelastic scattering with neutrinos. We can measure sin squared theta w with neutrino, with the pure. We can look for dark photon for beyond standard model, because we have an enormous amount of statistics and a capable detector just to look at that without changing anything while we are doing the other job. And this is, for instance, the sensitivity where you can see for steroid neutrino. So just to conclude, I think that the best way in which we really honor the heritage and the legacy of Juliet and Paolo is just to get this detector together with many of the people who have built it and let it continue and doing physics for the next 20 years. And I think that Paolo and Juliet would like it very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sergio. Very, very, very nice and interesting presentation. There is time for a question. Is Ludovico.
So there are many questions, but I want just a curiosity. The cryostat, since the drift time is 2 milliseconds, you have to have extremely pure argon. Now, cleaning the argon, I understand, but how do you clean the cryostat?
Well, the cryostat, I mean, big cryostat have an advantage, is that they have a volume to surface ratio, which is convenient. So it will take time, as always, but it has been proven in the one at the two cryostats at CERN are large because they are not 60 meters, but 10 by 10 by 10. And there, the purity well below the part per billion was reached in 1-2 months. So in principle, should be better there if you start with clean. And of course, you have just to clean it a lot at the beginning with flowing in, yeah, exactly, gas.
Well, Sergio, I think it's very, very nice to have Chloe living again on the other side of the ocean. But this was a remark that I wanted to do also this morning when I listened to the Rico talk. I think there is one person, of course, in addition to Paolo and to Juliet, which shaped our detector in a fantastic way, which was the work of Guido Petrucci.
Yes.
Because without Guido Petrucci, which left us five years ago, it would have been impossible to have both the chamber and the very nice structure that we will use again for the iron and all the mechanism of hanging, having a self detector, which was not only capable of holding the pieces, but also to bring the piece inside the detector, which is the crane on top. And I remember, remember as well, more precisely, the fact that Paolo and Guido were not, there were very hot discussion among them. I remember during the preparation of the cryostat.
There was a buffer.
Yes, so, and because Paolo was strong, but Guido, I think, was even much, even stronger than Paolo. So, I think Guido gave us a way of thinking to mechanics in a way which I think nobody was used before.
Yeah, no, I think that one of the value of Chloe is this combination of very sophisticated mechanics. I mean, this is the only magnet in my experience in all this year, then when you switch it on, it doesn't sing. It's not making so because it's precise, is self-assembled, is aligned. In this case, it's comparatively easier because we are bringing in all the structure, we have just to put in something which is sophisticated but not impossible and is not and we have a good group of engineering. Fabrizio Raffaele is working on that here in Frascati. There's four groups, Stefano Gazzana and others, and more are coming. So it's Fermilab itself will have they will want not just to have a detector which is has only one flag inside. So we will have collaboration from the Fermilab engineering. I think that what will be difficult just to do is the logistic. The logistic is very complex because shipping all this stuff there, I don't care about the iron, which we have already a quote for a company, I mean, it can be done. But shipping the calorimeters and being sure that they arrive as they started is less reassuring. But all in all, I think that we'll do it. Just to give you the time scale, our plan is just to ship everything from here, second half of 2024. And then be ready just to remount things after testing all the things in 2027.
Time for the very last question.
Actually, you basically anticipate. So which is the time scale, I mean, of the full new project?
The two detectors, the so-called phase one, we will start with two FAR detector, which means with at least 20,000 tons of fiducia volume, each one of these, which is one half of what was seen for the full thing. And the FAR detector with two detectors, we start taking data without the beam, with atmospheric supernovae and all the rest in 2020, end of 2026, 27. We will start having beam in 2030, end of 2029, nobody believes that, let's say 2030. And then the first phase will go on for 5 years, at least. In the meantime, there is already the other two modules being, they are called modules of opportunities. So there are people who want just to have different technologies in there. Maybe also there are people who would like just to move away from liquid argon. But there are interesting ideas, like for instance, inside this huge liquid argon detector, you put a specialized part just to make your wild dream, dark matter, double beta decay experiment, having a super ultra part at the center, surrounded by the best possible veto that you can, because down there, meters of, and so there are people working on that also. So is a 30-year program, it's not.
As we have seen also for the camps after all. So it's they are all a long scale projects. Okay, thank you very much. I think we should thank again Sergio. And now we move, if not physically, at least ideally to the other side of the ocean, where I hope there is Graziano connected. Are you there, Graziano?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, perfectly. So you can, I don't know, then you have your transparency?
Yes. Okay, 1 second. Share, yep. I hope you can see the slides.
Yes.
Let me go to full screen. Okay.
Okay. So go ahead. Thank you very much.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Fabio. I have a echo. Okay. Thank you, Fabio, and all the organizers to give me the opportunity to talk in this occasion, which is very nice. And okay, I have just a few slides with some personal comment. I'm here in this picture, much younger. Here you can see Franco, Juliet, Temuriaz, and other people that you recognize very well. And as many other colleagues, I had the privilege to be in Frascati during the CLO years, first as a student and then as a researcher. I think behind me there is Stefano Biscetti. So it was younger. And I was deeply influenced by Paolo and Juliet, I think as all the people who met them, and for their passion for physics, enthusiasm, the informal approach, which I'm missing very much in these days, scientific clearness and rigor, which were always an example and guide, at least for me. And in this period, especially as a co-spokes of G minus two experiment, I often think to them, especially when I am in front of difficult questions. And so I ask myself what Paolo and Juliet would have be done in this case. And of course, I don't know, but I hope to do the best way. And I miss really very much Paolo and Juliet, and I'm sure that I would have been very differently without knowing and interacting with them for, I think, 20 years. This is a slide that has been already shown by Gino, and I took from his contribution. I think it's really remarkable how many young people at that time, now we are older, were present and working in Chloe, which was really a legacy. So so I have to talk about the G minus two. So there is really a strong connection between Paolo Juliet and G minus two, because they were since the very beginning very, very interested to the G minus two, and of course to the hadronic cross section. And during the years, I had almost continuous interaction with them, often in my office. I shared the office with Erika, and sorry, Erika, she knows very well, but sometimes in their office, which preluded to, I mean, some more insight discussion. And their contribution, criticism, and advice was always very constructive and helpful. And I remember that Juliet was a referee of all the ISR memo. It was not easy. It was not easy. I mean, it was a difficult sometime discussion, but I would say that it was always very constructive. And Paolo was strongly edited the physics paper of the hadronic cross section, as well as mostly of the other papers of Chloe. So a personal remark is also that when in 2009 I decided to embark in the G minus two adventure, I have to say that they gave me a strong encourage support, which was not always the case. So they really support me and say that this is something that you should do that. And in the last year of my activity at Frascati, I met often Paolo and discussed with him the G minus two physics and the experiment. And I remember very nicely this discussion. So in this slide, you show Juliet and Paolo. Juliet was more focused on the hadronic cross section, and especially with ISR, and Paolo more the G minus two. And I took from this note on the right, which is unpublished, a sentence which gives you the character of Paolo. So he concludes, please avoid saying that the anomaly, a dimensionless quantity, is a magnetic moment, anomalous or not, which is dimensionful quantity. That is a gross conceptual mistake. So Paolo reminds us that he's a professor. And this is something, of course, true. And now, after many years, finally, the A mu is called the mu anomaly, which was not the case previously. So let me say that Paolo and Juliet and the Born of ISR, so the G minus two physics through the measurement of hadronic cross section was part of the Chloe program. Unfortunately, however, let me say, Daphne was not optimized for energy scan, what was the common way in which you measure the hadronic cross section. And here is a very nice picture, I thank Wolfgang Kluge to provide me, and which showed the participant at the Chloe workshop at Karlsruhe in 1996, which was a milestone, was really seminal for this activity. Because at that time, I think it was essentially realized that doing the measurement of the cross section, the Chloe will not be as easy because, I mean, we have the Daphnes, the permanent quadruples, it's not easy to scan the energy. Nevertheless, I mean, Paolo was presenting this proposal, I mean, or at least considerations. And there was also a very interesting thesis, which I studied very deeply by Giorgio Cavibbo, was colleagues and I was young at the time. And of course there is the Daphne study group, and I have to thank Leah in particular on that, not only, but there are really eminent, very important physicists here. And there was also at that time the contribution by Riccardo Barbieri, Remidi, on the hadronic contribution to the G minus two. Now, in 1998, 1999, there was the idea of ISR. And really there was a flourishing of paper, we can say, because it was realized that essentially that Chloe could not do the energy scan easily, let me say, so the idea was to use the photon from the initial state and look the rest. And it was a luck for me. I was very lucky, I have to say, because in 1999, I started a postdoc in Karlsruhe, thanks to the EuroDAFNE activity, European project, which was managed and proposed by Lia Pancheri. So I really, I'm always thankful to Lia. Was really an exceptional period that with a lot of physicists, a lot of interest, a lot of physics, unbelievable. And I was lucky because that period I had the fortune, let me say, to meet and to know all of these people, Wolfgang, Achim, Stefan, there was also young people like Deborah. Paolo Beltrami was now a Jesuit and researcher, so he played in an unfair way. And Barbara, Hans, and of course, Fred, who was in Berlin. I was formerly a postdoc of Fred, which is a little bit strange, but he was very tight with the Carlson node. And of course, there were also very important contributions by Stefania Spagnolo of Lecce, who did the part of his PhD thesis on this idea, Federico Nguyen, Marco Incaglia for Roma 3, Marco Incaglia, Stephanie Falco from Pisa, and the theorist Eric Cisse, German Rodrigo, and many other colleagues joined later. This was really a worldwide effort. This was really a worldwide effort because we started in Chloe, but at the end, it was also done in Babar, which did a huge number of channels. And indeed, Babar now, the biggest contribution of the Hadronic Cross-Section come from Babar, and also from BELS3, we join later. And we expect also that BEL2 will join soon. This is a hot topic. Now, I come to the muon G-2. And of course, you know that if you have a charged particle which make an orbit, the ratio between the magnetic moment and the angular momentum is divided to the Bohr magneton, is what we call the gyro magnetic ratio, G or Landé factor G. So we know the classical G is equal one, but we know that in 1928, Dira, as one of the bonus of his equation, found that G is equal to, which at that time was really a very unexpected result. At this point, only two graduate students were claiming that from Netherlands. Okay, so if G is equal to, A is equal to zero. So A, what is called the magnetic anomaly, which is how much G is different from two fractionally, so divide two. Okay, now we know that G is not equal to, of course, but we know that we can compute the mu anomaly very precisely. And we can divide, I mean, all the sector of the standard model, not the gravity, of course, gravitational force, but all the sector of the standard model contribute to the mu anomaly. And we can divide two different class. I mean, we know that the QED and the weak are precisely known, while the hadronic contribution have a large uncertainty, okay? And one of the alpha authors did this physics report. They are the so-called Theory Initiative, who wrote more than 100 page report, worked for 5 years, and they compute one single number. Okay, this was the state of the art in 2020. And you can appreciate the remarkable precision on this calculation, which took really a lot of years. Of course, they were sitting on the shoulders of giants, because this calculation was started really in the 60s, in the 70s, in the 80s, and but was really formalized and computed this precision in 2 years ago. Okay, however, this was the situation in 2020, but things change. We thank the scientific method for that. And from the a plus and minus dispersive approach, which was used to compute the hadronic leading order, now a new gang is in the town, which is the lattice community. And they want to show that they are also good to able to compute this quantity. And in particular, there was one group, which is BMW20, which had reached the accuracy, the fantastic accuracy of lattice calculation of 0.8%. And you can you can imagine that this values was different from a plus and minus based value of the hadronic leading order contribution. So there is really something which must be clarified. And there is a hot topic intensive work, but let me also mention that there is also a very interesting alternative approach, which is what we call MUNI, which is an experiment at CERN, which plan to measure a mu HLO experimentally. So in a completely opposite way respect to the theory of the lattice, using muons on the electron target, which is NA7++, let me say, in a way. Okay, so this is the theory, but of course we are interested also to the experiment. And to the experiment, the question is how we are able to measure the mu anomaly so precisely. And the reason is that the mu anomaly is given by the difference of two frequency, the spin precession frequency and the cyclotron frequency. And this difference of these two frequencies that we call the anomalous precession frequency is tied to the magnetic field through the mu anomaly A. So if you believe Dirac, so G equal 2, A is equal 0, the two frequencies are the same. So this means that the two arrow, let me say, the spin and the momentum are locked, are aligned, and keep aligned during the movement in the orbit. But if A is larger to 0, you see that there is a disalignment. So the spin start to rotate intorno to the momentum. So essentially, the anomalous precession frequency is what we measure, one of the two quantities that we measure, which is the rate at which the spin advances respect to the momentum. And the other quantity that we measure is the magnetic field. So by the ratio of the two, we got A. Okay, this is the question. Now, a quick tour on the history of the muon G-2 experiment started from Columbia in 1957, which was just after the Young Lee parity violation paper, which was, if you can see this as a result, one of the confirmation of the parity violation in a way. But this was interesting because this measure really G. So essentially pions were stopped, they produce muons, muons arrived to a carbon target, and then there is a magnetic field which was varied in order to increase the precession frequency, and the limited acceptance made this behavior, oscillation behavior. And you compute G, and G is equal to. At that years, it was realized, not in Columbia, but in Liverpool, by a similar experiment, that the cyclotron frequency and the precession frequency differ only by radiative correction. So if you want to measure really a mu, so the radiative correction, you can measure the difference between the two frequencies. And this was what the legacy, we could say, at CERN, muon G-2 experiment, because this allowed, from the experimental point of view, to do a free order of magnitude improve in accuracy, because it was not measure G, but measure a mu, which is roughly 0.1%, so free order of magnitude more in precision. And this was, there was 20 years of experimentation there. And this was really where the muon G-2 experiment storage ring was really conceived and developed. Okay, I don't have much time, but the first was a very rough experiment where they injected the muons and there was a dipole, a magnetic field with the drift, and then it was extracted and it was measured at the forward back asymmetry. And at that time, the accuracy was 0.4%, let me say in this way, but which allowed to test the QED up to the second order. Then came really the storage ring. So they realized that if they want to do a more precise experiment, they have to increase the energy of the beam, of the muons, and to collect more muons to have a more intense beam. And then they come with the idea of the storage ring, where they inject in the CERN one, the first experiment, protons. And then they were able to improve significantly the accuracy, and they were able to test the QED to the third order. But really the breakthrough on this experiment came with the CERN 3. So CERN 3 with the concept of magic momentum. In the CERN 2, the confinement of the muons were done by weak focusing, which was not good because we have to know the gradient of the magnetic field. And so this is not it's not easy to do. So they realized that if you run at the magic momentum, which is 3.1 GeV, you can have electrostatic quadruples for vertical confinement, and this cancel in the expression of the mu. So essentially, mu is still the ratio between the perception frequency and the magnetic field. So they came with the idea, and this really was, and for the first time, they were able to inject pions on the storage ring. This was a picture, and really they arrived at 7.3 ppm. It's always a progress towards better accuracy. At that time, this was the first experimental evidence of the hadronic contribution in the vacuum polarization. And so they were testing the mu at this level of precision. Okay, then all this technology was essentially shipped from CERN to the other coast of the Atlantic, as Sergio was saying before. So from in this case, from CERN to Long Island, and the idea is basically the same. So it's the idea of CERN 3, but of course the technology is much more refined. Let me say that the distinctive character of the Brookhaven experiment was, first of all, they were able to inject muons and not pions. You understand this is much better. And then you have a refinement on the knowledge of the magnetic field. First of all, they have a superconducting magnetic field, which was very uniform, the level of 2 ppm. And then they measured the magnetic field with NMR probes. They had almost 400 fixed NMR probes all around the ring, but also they were measuring every 2 or 3 days the magnetic field inside the vacuum chamber by moving a trolley with some lamp, which is essentially the same technology that we use in Fermilab. And of course, there was a refinement in the way in which they detect the decay positron of the muons with the calorimeter, et cetera. So this was really quite impressive because they were able to improve the results of the CERN 3 experiment by factor 15. And so to arrive to 0.54 ppm. At that level, you are very sensitive, not only to hadronic light by light contribution, but also to electroweak contribution. And this is history in a way, you know, that this experiment, which we're running at the beginning of 2000, show something like, I don't know, 2-3 sigma, depends, I mean, on the calculation, etc. But there was some hint of discrepancy at that time. And this was, of course, there was a hint of discrepancy. And this was, of course, the reason why Fermilab it was decided to do experiment at Fermilab. Of course, if you plan to find or to look for anomaly, Fermilab looks a good place. So this was a good choice. And we send the, essentially we shipped, I will tell you later, but we shipped essentially the superconducting magnet from Brookhaven to Fermilab, and then we constructed everything and that's all. Okay, so which were the difference, the key elements from Brookhaven to Fermilab? First of all, we used the consolidate method. So this was really development over 40 years, I would say, from the storage ring in CERN, CERN 3, to the Brookhaven. We had more muons, so a factor 20 more of Brookhaven. Of course, after 20 years after Brookhaven, you can imagine that the detector and is are improved, the detector. And then, of course, also the beam in the Fermilab is improved with respect to the AGS at Brookhaven, and this allows for reduced systematics. And then there is new ideas, and that's all. So at the end of the 20 time statistics of Brookhaven, the goal is to reduce by factor 4 the uncertainty of Brookhaven. So this means a factor 3 on the systematic and a factor almost 5 on the statistics. And the Brookhaven experiment was statistically dominated, this is important, while at the end of the full run in Fermilab, we will have an equal contribution from statistic and systematic point of view. So the storage ring method, we use polarized muons. So essentially the polarization muon is given by nature, which we tank, looking at the forward direction of the pions. And then we place these muons in a magnetic field, a dipole magnetic field of 1.47 Tesla. And we look at the anomalous precession frequency. We use the magic momentum, which was a legacy of the CERN experiment, and this cancels the electrostatic electric field produced by the electrostatic quadrupoles. And then we look at we measure the energy and the time of the decay positron, because we use positive muons. And the energy of the energy of the positron, especially the high energy of the positron, is modulated by the spin direction. And so you have this what is called Wiggle plot. However, you know that reality is, as we know, is much complicated what can be thought, and there are beam dynamics effect, and the beam inside the ring oscillate, and this is well known to the machine people. There is the betatron, what is called coherent betatron oscillation, which is the main frequency, and there is also the vertical oscillation that the beam also brief as a wall, and so on and so forth. So there are all of these corrections, which mostly of them are known by CERN, at CERN, and also in Brookhaven, of course. For example, I just brought here two corrections, which are quite important. The first is the fact that our storage ring allow for a slightly distribution of the momentum, which is 0.2% respect to the nominal value. This means that the muons will not all the muons will do ideal orbit, but they can be shifted, for example. And so they undergo the electric field. And so this is in the red is what we call the electric field correction, which is the largest correction. It's of the order of 500 ppb, but the uncertainty is 10%, so 50 ppb. The other correction, which is a smaller one, but nevertheless was important, so-called the pitch correction. So this means that due to the vertical oscillation, you have also a vertical component of the muons in the direction of the magnetic field. And so this modified the equation that I showed before, and you have to correct for that. Okay, in reality is done is that the magnetic field is expressed, is measured by combination of NMR probes. And this expressed in terms of the precession frequency of the proton, which are shielded in a spherical water sample in these NMR probes. So essentially what we measure is the ratio of two frequency, the anomalous precession frequency of the muons, and the proton armor frequency in the NMR probes, which are weighted for the muon distribution. And then we have to multiply this by some external factor. This is a simplified question. This is, if you look at the paper, it's more complicated, but the idea is that one. Of course, the genetic, in a way, of this experiment changed, because in Brookhaven it was mostly American experiment collaboration, not only but mostly, while here it was really international collaboration. So the MuonG-2 is more than 200 collaborators from 35 institutions, 7 countries. And what is peculiar, I will say, to this experiment is that really is the intersection of 3 different communities. You need the expertise from the accelerator physics, not only to produce the muons, but also to study the beam dynamics effect inside the ring. Then you need the nuclear community to study the NMR and to measure the magnetic field. And then, of course, the particle physics community for the calorimeter, etc. Okay, so as I told in 2013, this UFO object, this monolithic object, which is the 3 superconductive solenoid coils shipped left from BNL and arrived to Fermilab. And I show you a movie that was taken when this magnet arrived in Fermilab and showed the reassembly of the magnet. which took 1 year. This is a superconductive magnet, so then it was also put at cryogenic temperature, which is essentially four degree Kelvin. And you show all the steps, the assembly of the iron yoke, the vacuum leak testing, the magnetic pole piece installation after that. Yeah. All these elements are extremely important to provide uniformity at the level of 1 ppm. And then there is passive shim installation, then it was cooled down to 4 degree Kelvin at superconductive temperature. So it took 1 year to assemble and to bring the superconductive temperature. Okay. So 2015, we have the 1.5 Tesla a superconductive. Okay, so we use, of course, the feature of the so-called muon campus in Fermilab, and essentially there is a proton batch of 8 GeV, which is from the booster is sent to the recycler. In the recycler, divided by 4 bunches, and each bunch is of about 10 to 12 protons. Is heated, is extracted, of course, and then heated against the target inside the lithium lens, where the decay product or the particle which are produced, which are protons, of course, but mostly pions, are allowed to decay in this delivery ring in such a way that after about 2 or 3 kilometers, this mu almost intensive, but almost 100% pure muons beam arrive in the G-2 ring. Okay, this is a picture of the G-2 ring. So the muons arrive from here above. Then there is an inflector, which is, was also present in Brookhaven and also at CERN, I have to say. So it is a region which where a small superconductive magnet cancel, compensate for the dipole main magnet. So this means the muons can travel straight. They are off orbit. And then there is a series of kickers, free kickers here, which give a quick pulse, but intense pulse. Quick means 150 nanoseconds, just to be clear, because 150 nanoseconds is the period, the cyclotron period. So they want to just to give a kick in the first period, the first cycle. And so they put the muons in the orbit. And then the muons in the orbit rotate for 200,000 of times. And during the rotation, they decay in positron, which are catched, so the energy and the time, by 24 calorimeters, which are lead fluoride calorimeters, which are very fast. Inside the vacuum, which is 10 to minus 7 torr, few times 10 to minus 7 torr, there are two straw tube stations. One is placed at 180 degrees respect to the muons injection, the other 270 degrees. These are very important because they make a tomography of the muon behavior. And then there is four electrostatic quadruples, which are banded, you see, which are important, placed symmetrically in the ring, which are important for the vertical confinement. And then, as I told you, there are almost 400 fixed probes, which is, as in Brookhaven, they were placed all around the ring. Okay, so the fixed probes is this one. This is what we call the trolley, so which is placed with 17 NMR probes, which measure the ring inside the vacuum. Okay, so the data, so this is a really updated status of our data taking. So we are collecting almost 17, I think we are now about 17 BNL. So one BNL is statistics, the whole statistic of the BNL experiment. So we are 17, so we are close to 20, which is our goal. And of course, in the remaining slide, which are few slides, I will show you the result of round one, but this was said many times, so it will be quite fast. Of course, a characteristic of our experiment is it is a blinded experiment. So we have two levels of blind. One is the hardware, where we detune the frequency, which is measured by the analyzer, so the precession frequency, by quantity which is unknown to the collaboration, and revealed only after the completion of the analysis, and there are no remaining issue. There is also a software frequency, which is where we put an offset in the analyzer, so that they really cannot compare the true numbers. But then when the analysis are finished from the analyzer, they can remove this software offset and they can compare. And this is before removing the hardware offset, which is the last step. So when you do, of course, a measurement like that, you need to be very careful. And so we had multiple analysis group with different methodology and tools which are different sensitivity to systematic errors. So there are really six groups which analyze omega A with different method, two groups for omega P, and there are different groups for the beam dynamics. Okay, we have just a few minutes and then we'll finish. So the omega A measurement is, you know, very well. It's, I mean, it's a textbook measurement. It's if you cut, I mean, the number of positron above a certain threshold, oscillate. And if you cut, so above a certain energy threshold, then you count this oscillate, and they are modulated not only by the K length of the muons, but also by the precession frequency. Of course, if you want to fit what is called the Wiggle plot with this equation doesn't work, you need to improve, but this is the reason why we have young people. They are very good with that, and they are able to fit this equation with the 22 fit parameters. So with a function with 22 parameters. Okay. So the magnetic field is measured very high precision at the level below, of course, below 100 ppb, and the uniformity. If you look here, this is a map of the magnetic field inside the vacuum region, which is measured by the trolley, and you see that the level of uniformity arrives at 1 ppm, but only at the edge. Okay, and since the trolley are done when there is no beam, what is important also is to interpolate the two points with really the value of the magnetic field inside the vacuum region. And we know that the fixed probe measure the magnetic field outside the vacuum region. So there is really an analysis method to correlate the time and the space of these points. Okay, this is the results, which is well known. And essentially our results were in very good agreement with the BNL1 that allowed to make a combination. We were 4.2 sigma, we are 4.2 sigma respect to the standard model based on the plus and minus delta. Now it's important to say. So we are seeing something new, I don't know. Of course, now it's difficult to say because first of all, we have to clarify the theoretical prediction, but I am confident that this will be settled in a way. And what is, I think it's important to say is that we have analyzed only 5%, I will say, of the final data set. There is run 2 and 3 ongoing, and the results are expected by beginning of next year. And we plan to reduce the uncertainty by factor 2. So I think this is important because it will be not only a confirmation, a results with respect to previous one, but also, I don't know, it will be a more precise results. Okay, so we are now in the run of run 5. We will finish this year, and then next year we plan to do a run with negative muons, so muons with opposite charge. Okay, let me say very briefly that there is also important a different experiment, which is Planet JPark, which they plan to use to measure the muon generator 2 in a novel approach, which is based on ultra cold, low energy muon beam injected into small but high uniform magnet. So this is completely different approach. They don't need electric field, et cetera. And I know that the proposal is in progress. So they are really doing proposal and the test. And we look forward for their experiment soon, the next year. And finally, I want to say that let me take back the what I said at the very beginning. So the question of the hydraulic and hydraulic polarization. And it came this idea of the measuring the hadronic vacuolization at CERN while I was in Frascati, I have to say. And this, the genesis of this is quite interesting in a way, but okay, I don't have time now to tell you, but there are of course references, and this is a project which is going on also. So I think this is important. So I would conclude, I talked more than 30 minutes, so I would like conclude with the words of Paolo in a presentation 2001. So he lists the unsatisfactory points of the muon G minus 2. At that time, he had 2.6 sigma, which is not compelling. Now we have 4.2 sigma, if you believe to the theory initiative recommended value. But he say correctly, it's also author-dependent. So this is not really auto-dependent this moment. Now, really, we have a difference between if you use a plus, a minus, and the lattice. But nevertheless, there is this question. I think now the MC, I think, is the missing contribution, which is more too electroweak. And you already mentioned the possibility to correlate the possible new physics with the LEP, the KOB, MW, etc. Of course, he stated hadronic correction is difficult, which is true, light by light, but also hadronic vaporization. And then his comment on the SUSY, which it seems that he doesn't believe very much to SUSY, or didn't believe very much to SUSY. But okay. But anyway, the positive news is that it's still very exciting in the present. So it was present at the time and certainly is present now. So thank you very much for this kind of attention. Can you hear me?
Yes, so we are okay. Open it.
Thank you.
So I think that there is time for one question, and then we go to the last part of our meeting. So anybody wants to ask questions to Graziano?
I'm confined in my room.
Apparently, everybody is satisfied with your presentation. We are just waiting for new data and new results, obviously.
Yeah, it should be next beginning of next year. We should be ready, probably.
Okay, so at present, you are in the United States taking data, yes?
Yes, yes, yes. And it's also very cold here in Farmila, I have to say. A few degrees Celsius.
Okay. So we have arrived to the final session of our.
Okay, thank you very much, Fabio, and everyone.
Thank you to you, Graziano. Thank you very much. To the final session of our meeting, our small workshop, in which everybody is allowed to make short.